Good morning, everybody. Welcome to this meeting for the Liverpool City Region Overview and Scrutiny Committee. We've just been chatting members again. Julie's had quite a few apologies, so it's like a double meeting for the board. We'll just run through that first, though, so.
Yes, I've received apologies from Councillor Maguire, Councillor Wainwright, Councillor Cashman, Councillor Johnston, Councillor Lewis and Councillor Spall. The quorum for the meeting is 14, so only 12 of you present. So if you are minded, we can continue in an informal capacity, but that is entirely up to yourselves. No formal decisions will be made today. They would be bound open until the next meeting in April.
Councillor.
Hi, yeah, this is sort of following on from the last meeting that was in court. So we're having one meeting, so this would be the second meeting that's in court, so no decisions are going to be taken. So at the following meeting, does that mean then that for the last two meetings, we're going to have to put the decisions forward again?
Yes.
That'd be right.
Yes.
Right, okay.
The
can we continue like this?
No, we can't.
Well, since we've gone up to 20 members, we're having difficulty actually becoming quorate. Would it not be logical at the AGM in April or June, whenever it is, to actually allow each authority to have one reserve? And when a member of the authority can't turn up, then at least the reserve member should be able to. I think only to be helpful, Joe, to make us correct and make the meetings actually useful.
I'm pretty sure we have suggested that Joe Constitution.
I don't know whether it's appropriate to raise it now, but can we actually have a terms of reference for this group? Because I'm a bit struggling a little bit to know exactly what it is that we are supposed to be doing. We seem to be doing a lot of noting, but we don't seem to be doing a lot of scrutiny. I'm not quite sure where we are.
There are the terms of reference, so we can get you a copy of them.
Okay.
Obviously, the formal meetings here are to make decisions. But we do a lot of work in working groups as well, and a lot of that work just follow through in the old forms. So although these meetings we've struggled the last times, I think there's still a lot of work going on within the group and the committee members.
Thanks, Jo.
Councillor Baines, sorry.
Thank you, thanks, Jo. In terms of going forward with this meeting, can I just ask, is the Mayor coming? He's on the agenda. He is attending. If the Mayor's attending, he's here, I think we'll just carry on. If he's not, such a if he is here, it's nice to have someone else. Could I ask, excuse me, I'm still. In terms of is it not the case, rather than reserved, because it might be a case that they might not turn up by the call is too high. I think you've mentioned before, we've said a few times ourselves that the call is too high. I think the point was made.
I think we should carry on, but the Mayor's coming on last night. I think we should carry on with the business, or at least the council. councillors who are here, we can discuss issues that we want to raise. And I think if it's in the constitution we can't lower the court, I think it should go out to all authorities how important this is that councillors take on, take the individual responsibility. It does happen occasionally. I mean, I've been away, I think, once in 4 years, I've missed a meeting, or possibly two meetings. So it is important that the councillors who are on this committee are made aware, and I think the whips through all the councils should be made aware that it is important that we are for it. Because it is, it's a serious scrutiny committee, this, and we do some serious work, and it's for the good of all the people, and it's the whole region. Thanks, Jim.
I know that the officers have made
an
effort to ask all the members who were coming today, so we knew in advance. Unfortunately, not everybody responded, so you know, we didn't know until today, but there's those things on the day as well. But I think all the members, as you say, are taking forward within the groups as well to make sure that the groups are aware of the situation.
If members aren't turning up and not giving an apology, I think we should make it known to whatever authority they're from that it's not acceptable. Thanks, Chair.
So, we're happy to proceed as an informal meeting.
Yes, agreed.
Are there any declarations of interest?
I haven't received any, Chair.
The next item on the agenda is the minutes of the meeting of the 25th of October. These are actually notes of the previous meeting, which was an informal meeting. Is everybody happy to agree that they're not formal minutes? The next item on the agenda is an update from Metro Mayor Steve Rotherham. Members happy to move on to item 6 on the agenda, the task and finish groups. The discussion about that.
Yeah.
I'll just pass you over to Sue, just going to give us an introduction.
Thank you, Chair. The report is a procedural report, really just setting out the progress on the task and finish groups for the year. As members will know, we've just concluded our first task and finish group on spatial development strategy, and this note gives you the suggested date for the meetings of the welfare reform and the air policy task and finish groups. The question is just to feedback through to choose which of those dates would be the most appropriate ones that you would wish to attend.
Which of the groups? Councillor Sullivan?
Could I just raise a point there? We did agree to do the air quality control and to look at the universal credits and the ramifications of it. But I do think that as a scrutiny committee, the Mayor is busy at the moment formulating his budget. And I think at some stage, once the budget is announced, we as a scrutiny committee should look at the budget and do some scrutiny work on it.
We can take that away and put that.
Please.
Councillor Ryan.
Yeah, thank you. Yes, yeah. Just in terms of the dates that we've been given and all the people up there, given the issues that we're having in the previous conversation around people coming to the meetings and being called, I'm looking at the dates there, more or less there's a meeting every week. Now, I know that we had a particular issue, I couldn't maybe myself or the family reasons. We had a situation where we had So I'm just saying, what can we do, you know, from this perspective to make sure, is it about being in one of these particular issues to a later date. So the world changes. Are we getting enough quality and enough engagement and involvement in terms of making this a better process? No, in terms of we've got two different items. So I'm just putting that up there really, because you know, how many people are going to get concerned? What we've got reinforcing with the council that we need to get these meetings? What is it about, you know, is it about looking at reshaping what we're doing, these two in particular? I've got no most of the one there, you left. Just think in terms of discussion, what do you feel about that?
I think the previous meetings we have agreed to do the two groups. We don't need a quorum for these groups, and it is up to members to decide whether we can do one or both of the groups. I think they're both very important issues that we, as a committee, we wanted to take forward. And I think if we leave it to Trudy to take names, and we see what the balance is, and if we feel as though there's an imbalance on the groups, maybe we can circulate something.
So again, in terms of moving forward, it's a two-pronged thing then to make. It's about making sure we speak with our own authorities about the need to get people there, but secondly, enhancing the fact that these are serious issues, so they get attacked that people want to come to them and make a contribution. We need to do down that on two levels if possible.
Do we leave that with the two groups, and if members can feedback to Trudy which group or groups are happy to attend, given the dates have now been published? Trudy feels as though there's any issue, she can feed back to the committee. Okay. Are we happy to agree that at this stage? Okay. We'll move on to the update from Steve Robin, the Metro Mayor.
Thanks, Chair. I'm going to be able to stay after this update. I'm happy to take some questions and thoughts for I'll explain why, where it is that I'm off to immediately. I've just come back from an event in Liverpool University, again, trying to put forward what it is that Combined Authority is all about and what DVO should provide us as a platform to really start to take things forward. But I wanted to update you on a couple of things that have happened since we last met. One in terms of structure, and I know that's something that you're going to be discussing anyway, but also to take your views on the Combined Authority's first corporate plan. So since we met in October, there's been a considerable improvement in delivering the vision for the city region, which I think I outlined to you at that stage. So for instance, on the speech I gave on the 14th of November, I talked about the Mersey Tidal project and why it was deliverable now where it hasn't been previously. Well, we've made great strides in that because Brent Cheshire, who was the person who was responsible for Dong Energy, in other words, Baerbock Bank, so he started with one turbine and that's 3.5 megawatts. Last ones that he was responsible for were 8 megawatts, and it's the biggest offshore wind farm in the whole of Europe. So that person has agreed to come and head up the Mersey Tidal Commission. We got a visit from the Chancellor, the Shadow Chancellor, John MacDonald, for all you to say, last week, alongside the Shadow Business Secretary and the Shadow Chief Secretary to the Treasury, had a look at what the plans were for the Tidal barrage or project. And convinced our colleagues about its validity and about its time, that John has made a public statement saying this is the very sort of project that the National Infrastructure Bank would be funded and has promised us £3.5 billion from a future Labour government to ensure that this project comes to fruition. We're hoping that that will act as a spur now for the government to say that they also back this. The backing that we're some of their expertise. They've put in the devolution agreement. They've given us some opportunities, but of course, to develop these schemes, it takes probably a couple of £100 million. That's not something that we can find lying around. There's no magic wheel. So we need to ensure that the government do support us in the early stages so that we can develop this. In the last few weeks, we've commissioned consultants on a six-month contract, and that's to deliver the action plan that you spoke about, detailing on how to achieve the vision of all six districts being joined up in a digital loop, and that digital loop being connected to the Hartree supercomputer at one end, and then at the other end, the GTT transatlantic fiber optic cable that takes us to North America. Again, it's a six-month piece of work, but they will report back with not just its feasibility, because we know we've had the universities saying that this can work, about what we need to do to deliver the project as soon as possible. So the company are mapping out the existing infrastructure assets, identifying opportunities where to best use those assets, and suggesting potential operation models for the digital infrastructure. In the budget in December, the Naval Command Authority was rewarded by the Chancellor. So we got £134 million for something called Transforming Cities Fund. That's primarily for the transport projects, but through discussions with officials, it looks like there's plenty of flexibility within that fund. And we've got a share of £27 million for something called Housing First, approach to homelessness and to rough sleeping. So what we need to know now is the detail, and the reason I can't stay is because straight after this, I'm jumping in a car to get on a train to go to London to see Sajid Javid, who's the Secretary of State for Housing Communities and Local Government, and that's to discuss on how we spend this money. It's obviously government money devolved to us. We want to ensure that we get value for every single penny of that money. In November, I think it was just shortly before we met last, I attended the inaugural meeting of what's now being called the M7. So it's the six metro mayors and the London mayor, Steve Carr. We went to his fantastic offices in London, although they're not as good as ours, as we said. And the six metro mayors and Sadiq all signed a number of documents, including, it has to be said, a letter to the then Secretary of State for Education, just agreeing about the adult education budget and about the fact that it should already be as part of the devolved process with local combined authorities, and it's not yet. So if you think about that, that is cross-party. There's two Labour Metro Mayors, four Tory Metro Mayors, City Park, all parties signed up to this, and it shows you the importance of working collaboratively across party wise to try and get the government to do the right things. In June, we've got the International Festival for Business, an unbelievable opportunity, a real platform for our city region. If you think about it as a global event that just so happens to be in Liverpool, London had lots of these, but it is a great showcase for us, and we're doing a lot of things to ensure that, for instance, the M7, so all the mayors come to Liverpool City Region during that time. We need as many people to actually see what it is that we do, because I think once they see it for themselves, their misperceptions often are changed. I was really pleased and proud to announce in November that the Combined Authority was the first to be designated as a real living wage employer. That obviously is something where we can demonstrate what the Combined Authority is all about, to try and use that as a catalyst for others to sign up to become a real living wage employer. And shortly afterwards, Everton Football Club, who we already have, were joined by Liverpool Football Club, and that had no small part to play in the discussions that we have to combine authority with. I'm still doing those regular question times. In fact, I did one, I think, last week, I think it was, in Halton, where we invite members of the public right away across the borders to come and ask any questions that they want. We halted primarily on the Mersey Gateway Bridge, which we don't have responsible for, surprise, surprise, but it's still a great opportunity to listen because of that political disconnect that we always talk about. But we're going to continue all those. Now, I also do community engagement day, where I spend at least a day a month going to one of the six districts, spending the day there, talking to businesses, voluntary organisations, political group, business, whatever it is, the whole gambit, but try to get a flavour of what it is that differentiates the six districts, but also the commonality between them all. And I know that through the chair, there was a question, I think it was the end of last year, about structure. I'm pleased that that is on the report today. I think John's going to go through that. But we have signed off, command authority, right way through its structures, has signed off the high level part of the staffing structure, and that includes a director of commercial investment and development, which we've now recruited to, I'm very pleased to say, as some of you start very shortly. We've got a director of policy and strategic commissioning, which we've done the shortlisting, the interviews are on the 14th of Feb. A director of resources, which has been appointed, and when the combined authority budget hopefully is agreed on the 2nd of February, we're going to be in a position to appoint people to those additional roles. And then just on the corporate plan, we're at the very early stages of developing the CA's corporate plan, so I'd be very keen, Chair, to hear any members' views on the plan, what it should contain, what format it should take, etc., etc. And I think in the remaining few minutes I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thanks for that, Steve. Very informative. Thank you. Steve, there's no capacity for resources built in from the government. How are you proposing? You haven't been over to the world yet. How are you proposing to pay for your staff? Where's that money? You've been to other authorities, so I've heard rumours and whispers and Chinese whispers even. So how are you proposing to get the resources to pay for the staff?
So just imagine that in politics there'll be rumours and conjecture and speculation and lies. What I think we need to do is, we've been given a window of 12 months. Everybody was under the apprehension that the game share money could be used for one cost for the combined authority. So you get £30 million, everyone knows, 25% of that is revenue. To date, some of that revenue has been used for day-to-day run costs of the combined authority. There's an expectation by the government that we will find an alternative. So there are a number of different scenarios that we have examined, and what has happened and will be hopefully confirmed on the 2nd February, which is the budget day, is that in the interim, the local authorities will find the running costs. That buys us then 12 months so that we can have a look at all of the options, and that would include a subscription. It would include some sort of revenue generation, so returns on savings, how soon we can get that back. It would include a precept, the mayoral precept. You'll probably be aware that in Greater Manchester, they're going for a mayoral precept this year. In West Midlands, they potentially are still going to go for a precept. It was rejected initially, but the way this works is that it's a mayoral budget. So it's not a command authority budget, it's a mayoral budget. So the mayor puts the budget forward, it needs two-thirds of people to reject it. If it was rejected, the legal position is that the local authorities have to find the group. So in our case, £6.2 million was the budget in 2015, 16, 16, 17. the local authorities would have to find some point £2 million, so say £1 million each if you wanted to portion it out. It'd be more likely to be on a pro rata or a population basis, but they'd have to find that. So we've bought some time in which we can have a look at what is the best way in which we can assure the sustainability of the funding model for the combined authority.
Can I just come back then, Chair? How are you proposing the starting staff now, which I'm glad to hear? So how are you proposing to pay them for the next 12 months before the six leaders and yourself decide how we're going to pay, whether it's a preset or levy? I did hear last night from one of our senior officers that we might be looking at a loan
year. I thought that's what I was saying. The six districts or find money to ensure that we've got the running costs as a loan until we get a sustainable funding model, and then obviously that loan will be paid back. But that's the current proposals that I think are going out to probably tonight or tomorrow afternoon. So that's
I think that's going out to the public right now.
No, I mean the documentation, so all of the detail of that will be available from tomorrow. It's not like trying to hide anything.
No.
What we're trying to do is to buy ourselves some time, because these orders, the government orders, it was fairly ambiguous, to tell you the truth, and not an awful lot of people picked up on this earlier. What happened was, obviously, we talked to the other local authorities, the combined authorities, the six of us. Who's not entitled to do this? So there's only five who can do it. Out of the five, three were looking towards doing it this year, one potentially next year. But for ourselves, we thought it was too big in a position to be asking people, because they've got 3% social care preset. Normally it'd be 2%, but we're allowed that 1% for local authorities now, and a lot of ours will go to the full 6%. You've got the increase in the police and crime commissioner preset, fire authority, so it looked a bit burdensome. So we're looking to see whether we can alleviate some of that concern for local council taxpayers.
I'm pleased to hear that. Thanks, Chair.
Sue's part of this process. What we're doing, we're going to get something which is a draft, a very, very early draft, and then people can feed in their concerns, their suggestions, their ideas. But it's meant to be a real living wage document. It's not something that we want to do and it lies on the shelf. It's supposed to be something that really starts to inform the way we want to do things and the culture by which that will be spelt out. So,
yeah, just to add to that, it's something that we could bring up as an agenda item to our discussion. Are there any other questions?
Thank you, Chair. We got down through the Constitution again on the point that Mike's made. You are saying there are now alternatives to raise the fund apart from the preset. If you actually look at the Constitution, it's quite clear that on page 107 it says the MERS expenses will be set by a preset. I found that interesting, that it's going to be paid by a preset, or it can be paid in other ways. I can understand why it's been deferred for the year. But I asked you the question when you came to Halton, and I wasn't quite sure of the answer, I've got to be honest. And that is the revenue of the £30 million that we are going to receive over the next 30 years. We thought 25%, and you did, I've got to be honest, that 25% of this, that's £7.5 million, would in fact be used to pay for the MERS funding. Now we're being told it's not. So what's the additional £7.5 million of your fund going to be paid in future? Because you're £7.5 million better off. Now, whether we raise the 6.2 million, which originally was the 7.5 million. But originally, that was supposed to pay for your expenses. Now it's not. So you can't save it twice. So you've got £30 million instead of 22.5. What are you expecting to pay the additional 7.5 million on? Can any of it be used to help offset or avoid going for the visa? Because I'm sure a lot of the borders will not accept the visa. I think it's the principle more than anything, Steve. It's not the money. The money, it's not a lot. I think it's about £12 a year in Alton. Well, if we don't pay that, it's £500,000. You know, that we would have to pay. I think the funding of the MER, unfortunately, is becoming difficult. I can understand it's got to be paid for. It's not costing back there. But it's difficult actually raising that sort of money. When you know it, you were a councillor many years ago. You've been a member of parliament. You know the pressures put on local authorities now. This is yet more pressure on top of ridiculous amount of pressure they've had to put up with for the last 10 years.
I absolutely understand the issues of austerity and the fact that those cuts are passed down to local councils having to make some of the most difficult decisions of anywhere in the whole country. But people often say, don't they, why do Manchester always get money, or why do London get favouritism, or why do the West Midlands end up getting big pots of money like they have done? And it's because they have capacity to develop pipeline projects. And we've never had that capacity. We've had five local authorities in Merseyside before Holland came on board, but basically a loose affiliation, whereas Manchester had AGMET, which is a much more structured approach, and they got like £70 million for the factory building. They've got all sorts of pots of money that people here rightly point to and say, why? And it's because we've never had the opportunity to do this as six local authorities. And in Holton, you need, as councillors, to explain to people that currently Holton has benefited by £40 million in the last 2 years of being part of this combined authority. And it's up to people then to decide whether they think that, you're right, an imposition of a precept would be worth it. It depends, I think, on what you get out of it, so what you'd be prepared to put into. But we have to find a solution to this. We've got 2 years to 2020, there's a gateway, and the government will assess us in 2020. And if we don't get it right, the government can, and they would be perfectly entitled to say, we'll withdraw them the £30 million. And then Holton won't be getting part of that money. So I think you're right, the expectation, I said that at the beginning, was that the 25% of the gain share, so the £7.5 million out of the £30 million, that would be used for mayoral run costs. It's not legally the correct assumption to have made. All I can tell you is that having been here for 8 months, and I'm doing what I can do now since I've been the Metro Mayor to put any issues that I've found to ensure that we do have that sustainable funding model for the future. And it means that we need to find currently £6.2 million. So we've just got £134 million. Fresh money from let's face it, it's from not the government of my persuasion, but a government, a national government, saying we will play ball with you because we said you get preferential treatment if you get your act together. So I think that we've been able to, in the 8 months, persuade the government that we are getting our act together. So it said there's £134 million. That's to be spent in our area, but it's all capital. So we don't get that, we can't spend it. If we have got the £6.2 million of revenue in order to ensure that we spend that money, that it's monitored, evaluated, reported, and all the things that you need to do. It's like a council. A council will get some money, but you need people to be able to run those services, to monitor those services. That's exactly what we are, but on a big scale. If you like, we're the government department. We've been, how it's devolved from Whitehall which now sit here. So the people who used to do it, the wise old mandarins who don't know anything about our area, we need to have people who do those roles but do understand our area. So you need money to be able to do that, and it's currently £6.2 million. So what's the alternative? As I say, the expectation in the orders is that it's a mayoral precept. Manchester and West Midlands and Birmingham look like they might be introducing it this year. We'll see. We'll find out on the 7th of February. Ours is that we're not, because the leaders wanted to buy some time, quite rightly, so that we can examine all of the alternatives. And that's where we're up to. But it could be a subscription. You can go for a subscription. Manchester have got a subscription, and Birmingham have got a subscription. And they're going for a precept as well, because they're identifying that if you build up a war chest of money, then you can develop schemes so that when the government has these pots of money that says, is anybody after some money for whatever it might be, they are best placed to get it. That's why they keep on getting the money. And we've got to do the same here. We've got to develop pipeline schemes so that we are ready for when those opportunities arise, national governments invest, we can say, we've got one of them. Mr. Officer Government come and invest in our area. Or we can all take our ball in 2020 and say, you know, we had a goal but it didn't quite work for us all.
Thanks, Steve.
Rich.
Questions?
Just one quick one, Steve. When are you coming to Wirral? As you know, I need to be invited. I'm not a dictator, so I've been invited to you know, other groups, and I'll go anywhere that I'm invited. I'm one of those people, so I don't know.
Well, I'll formally invite you, Stephen. Get a date in your diary. I'll invite you.
Rachel, sweet Stephen.
Are there any other questions?
So that was £22.5 million that we had in gain share. That was for capital projects. So we've reported on that. We spent more than £22.5 million, because what we were able to do with some of the revenue is to develop all the schemes. So we had people who were able to look at what potential pots might be coming down the road. And if you have a look at the combined authority minutes, you'll see the sheer volume of money that we've been able to attract here, that we've been able then to spend in the six districts, you know, money on all sorts of schemes that wouldn't have been available to us if we hadn't had the capacity to do that. So the £22.5 million, yes, that's gone on lots and lots of schemes. It all goes into something called the single investment fund. So if you have a look under the budget line, it'll be under, not under gains yet, it'll be under SIF. But SIF, for instance, some of the big projects that we've done on SIF, Holton, £5 million to Holton. Holton have developed or built a factory that contains or has the capacity for an 11 car pendulum train. Just think about the sheer size of that. It's a huge big shed. That was £5 million to ask. What did it do? Created jobs, proper apprenticeships at UG level 3 and above apprenticeships that have been deceased in the apprentices and all that. And you can go through every single one of our areas and you'll see that there are projects that have come through SIF, and that's the 22.5. Because we've had it for, this is the second financial year, so we've had £45 million just on the capital part of that, and we've had £15 million on the revenue. But for instance, on the revenue, £5 million for IFB, we just spoke about IFB, that has to come from revenue, we can't go from capital. The stuff for Liverpool 2018, the cultural programme, £5 million, and that is through our revenue funding. So if you want any information, we can provide it all for you. There's a breakdown of every single budget line and what we've been able to spend. But I'd guess, I'd hazard a guess at hundreds of millions of pounds over the last few years.
Okay, thank you.
Sorry?
That breakdown percentile?
Yeah. Does that, do you mean for individual boroughs or districts or budget lines? I think whatever you ask for, if you ask for it, you know, tell us what you want, John will provide. Well, John has provided that because we've gone through this budget process for 4 months, by the way. So this shouldn't have come as a surprise to anyone because we've been doing this for 4 months looking at alternatives. But John, in that 4 months, has provided a raft of information. So we can, anything you want, but tell us what it is that you do want rather than us second guessing and then you come back saying, well, that's not what I wanted in the first place. If you do it that way, you'll provide anything.
I'll just take one last question.
Yeah, it's just a very quick question. If we're going to be giving some $134 million and we don't spend it, does that actually get taken back by the government?
Yeah, we'll lose it. Well, not just that. There's loads of pots of money. So we get a fair share of housing first money, so that's £27 million. Unless we have the surety capacity to develop that project, which is over 3 years. But we can't start it. We can't start and set ourselves up for failure. We want to be successful. And also, you know, the government are looking at us and saying that we are, for the first time, I think, in their eye line of when they're looking for major infrastructure projects, for us to be one of the first ones in the queue, and that's what we need to do then, is to ensure that we can deliver on those projects, because you only have to fail and then you're not getting the next one, are you? Because the government doesn't want to be associated with failure. Brilliant. But you know what I mean? It's that sort of thing. We need to be really demonstrating that we can do what these other areas that we've often pointed to and said, why are they getting favouritism? Well, we're getting that favouritism now. We need to get our act right, so that we can deliver on them, be demonstrably successful. Honestly, in the future, if we get this right, that's why I think it's going to be so important. If we get it right now, then, you know, in 5, 6 or 7 years' time, when people say, well, what does this metro mayor actually do? What's the combined authority all about? People won't be asking those questions, because there'll be stuff that you'll see that's growing everywhere. It's like you have to build foundations, and sometimes they take a long time to get right, and that's what we're doing.
Attention, please. Right. Attention, please. We are about to commence a test of the fire alarm system. Do not take any action when you hear the alarm message.
Attention, please. Attention, please. An incident has been reported within the building. Please wait for further announcements. Attention, please. Attention, please. An incident has been reported within the building. Please wait for further announcements.
Attention, please. Attention, please. The fire alarm test is now complete. No faults have been reported. Thank you for your cooperation.
Right, I think that's it. Are we ready to reconvene on to the next item? We now move on to item number 5, which is an update on the implementation of the